I invite you to remain standing and turn in your Bibles to John chapter 18. John 18, verses 1 to 14. Hear the word of the true and living God. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the brook Kidron, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing there with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "Of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the band of soldiers and their captain and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him. First they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who advised the Jews that it would be expedient that one man should die for the people. Thus far the reading of God's holy and inspired word. You may be seated.
Let's pray together. Father, we come before you seeking to hear from you. We long for you to speak through your word. Lord, may your spirit make clear what you would have for us, for each of us. We all need different things, and your spirit knows us each, what we need at the right time. So Lord, deliver what you would have for us. Pray that everyone here would hear your word and be changed, that your spirit would be working within, and that we would go forth from here bearing fruit. Lord, may you take me out of the way. May you make my words come alive in the hearts of your people as only you can do. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we enter the final section of John today, in chapter 18. Kind of ending the discourse of Jesus to his disciples. We spent a lot of time from chapters 13 through 17. That's basically this one evening. We're ending Jesus' ministry and his formal teaching, and now we're entering into the final scenes of his life, which culminates in his death and resurrection and ascension into heaven. So John gives us his firsthand account of what happened in those final hours in the garden. So Jesus and the disciples, they're walking over to a valley near the city of Jerusalem into an olive garden, a place familiar to Jesus and his disciples. Now, in the other Gospels, we get this extended version of Jesus in the garden where we see Jesus praying. For example, in Matthew 26, verse 39, it says, "And going a little further, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, 'My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will.'" Jesus prayed like this multiple times until his will was resolved, knowing that there was no other way to bring salvation. Now, John does not record this prayer, but John just gives us the picture of Jesus who is already done struggling. He's done asking for a way out. He's done showing the weakness of his flesh, and now he's fully focused on the task ahead. He's got his game face on. He's ready to face death. And even more than that, he's ready to face the Father's wrath against human sin. So notice in this passage, in everything that Jesus says and does, he is willingly going over to his death, knowing all that was to happen to him. As he said before in John chapter 10, Jesus said, "For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father." So now I want us to consider a few ways where we see this, Jesus and his determination, his readiness to lay down his life. First off, it's where they go. Jesus goes to a familiar place. Judas knew about this, right? He often met there with his disciples. And so Jesus was not hiding from Judas, from the betrayer. But he did go out of town. And this is presumably so he had some time to pray. Now, second, when the soldiers do come out, Judas comes out with the Pharisees, Jesus approaches them. He doesn't let them come. He goes to them, knowing what they were there for. And he asks them, "Whom do you seek?" When they answer that they are seeking him, the only thing that he tells them is that if they're just seeking him, they should let the others go. And third, when Peter begins to fight back, cutting off a man's ear, Jesus sharply rebukes him, saying, "Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?" And so we see that though Jesus is the one to be arrested, he is actually the one that's in control. He is going to his own death of his own accord. No one could take his life from him without his consent. So Judas's betrayal, the soldiers in the garden, the disciples fleeing, all of it is going exactly according to God's predetermined plan, as foretold in the Old Testament scriptures. So with that backdrop in our minds, let's examine the text some more. Now, the first interesting thing in chapter 18, after we talk about the context right there in the garden, is this dialogue. Jesus comes to the soldiers. "Whom do you seek?" "Jesus of Nazareth." Well, now, picture the scene here. Okay, it's dark. It's late at night. The only light is coming from torches. Now, if you've ever lit a stick on fire and walked around, you realize it doesn't give off that much light. And partly that's because it's shining right at you, just as bright as it is everywhere else. And so the soldiers are coming to arrest a man whom they probably have never seen before. And as they come into the garden, there's a group of men, Jesus and some of his disciples. But aside from Judas, it wouldn't be clear to anyone who the right guy was that they were going to arrest. So naturally, the soldiers approach the group, and a bold man walks up to them and says, "Whom do you seek?" And they respond, "Jesus of Nazareth." And he says, "I am he." Well, that in itself would be kind of startling. But there are more things going on behind what we initially see in the text. Look at the response of the guards. What do? They drew back and fell to the ground. Why? Jesus didn't have any weapons. Jesus wasn't physically threatening them in any way. But when he spoke, they fell to the ground. Now, what I believe happened here is that Jesus revealed a taste of his divine power when he said this. Now, the Roman soldiers, right, these are probably strong and brave young men, not knowing who Jesus was, they felt something. They felt his power, and were struck with enough fear, it caused them to draw back and fall to the ground. For a split second, it's as if they tasted the power of God and trembled. When a man comes into contact with the awesome power of God, he falls on the ground. We see this when the risen Christ met Saul and all his companions on the road to Damascus. Every one of them fell down on the ground as though dead. The power of God makes the hearts of men tremble. especially that of the unbelieving. And now there is also another reason for fear for any one of them who knew the scriptures. So along with the soldiers, there's also the officers of the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they heard Jesus say, "I am he." In the Greek, it's just ego, I, me, which literally means I am. So what is Jesus doing here? Well, they know what Jesus is doing. They've charged Jesus with blasphemy before, and here it is again. Jesus is making himself equal with God. Jesus saying, I am, is a reference to the divine name of God, the I am. Right? In the Old Testament, and in Isaiah in particular, God uses this phrase numerous times to describe himself. For example, Isaiah 43, verse 12, God says, "I declared and saved and proclaimed when there was no strange God among you, and you are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and I am God. Also, henceforth, I am he." There it is. "There is none who can deliver from my hand. I work, and who can turn it back?" Jesus identifying himself with the divine name, coupled perhaps with a divine power from his voice, terrified everyone who was coming there to arrest him. Now, so they fall down, and Jesus advanced towards them again, asking again, "Whom do you seek?" "Well, Jesus of Nazareth." Now Jesus says again, "I told you, and I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." Now at this development, it's like the fear of the previous moment, right? They just fell down in fear. It's like that was all forgotten. Because in a few moments, these same men would bind Jesus, arrest him, and take him away to be put on a mock trial. I see this as a typical characteristic of the unbelieving. They have a fear of God, but they do not repent. They fear his judgment, they fear his wrath, but their depraved mind suppresses all thoughts of an afterlife in hell. And we see this in Romans 1, where it tells us that they have suppressed the knowledge of God and his eternal power and his divinity, even though God has shown it to them through the things that have been made. And yet this blindness, this depravity, that's also God's judgment on the unbeliever as he hands them over to their sinful desires. Therefore, may we fear the judgment of God on unbelief. We read also in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4, it says, "The God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God." Now those soldiers and Pharisees and Judas, they all had one more glimpse, a taste of the glory of Jesus and his divine power, but they were unmoved by it. It did not change their hearts. They did not repent. They feared for a second, and then they continued on as if nothing had happened. So for us here today, may we also examine ourselves. Are we also like the soldiers who saw Christ, they felt his power, yet continued on in unbelief? My friends, have you not yet bowed your knee to Christ? Have you not yet accepted your own sinfulness and helplessness before him? Well, if you hear his voice now, do not harden your heart, lest you also become blinded to the light of the glorious gospel of Christ. Repent from your unbelief. Turn to Christ to seek salvation. He will not turn you away. So Jesus said again, "I told you, I am. Therefore, if you're looking for me, turn these men loose." Now I noticed again right away, Jesus has concern, not for himself, for his disciples. We've seen that over and over again in John. Jesus is the one in trouble, and yet he's concerned about his disciples. Even now as he's arrested, he doesn't call on his friends to help him. No, he tells the guards to let his friends go. And this is the character of Jesus, the true picture of a protector, a leader willing to sacrifice himself for his people. Jesus is willing to protect those around him by taking the punishment himself. And we'll come back to this theme at the end of the passage. Now in verse 9, we see that Jesus made this request for his disciples, asking that they would be let go, because he was fulfilling what he had said in his prayer earlier that evening. He said, "Of those whom you gave me, I have not lost one." Now he's referencing the prayer that we read about in chapter 17. And he mentioned one exception. "I have not lost one except the son of destruction," which was Judas. Now, Jesus was not praying merely for their physical bodies, but rather their spiritual state before God. Now, Judas was still alive. He had not perished yet, but he was lost in his soul. And the other disciples, they were not lost spiritually, but Jesus, knowing his disciples perfectly, would also have known their current faith, their current spiritual strength. He knew their weaknesses, and he knew that they were not yet ready to face death for him. And though nearly all of the disciples went on to face a martyr's death later in their lives, at this point, they were not yet ready. And so Jesus asks the soldiers to spare his disciples from the trial that only he was ready to endure. And so there's a principle here, and I want to spend some time looking at this. The principle is that Christ knows his people. He knows his disciples, and he does not give them trials for which he has not prepared them. And that is, he does not send them to battle unarmed. When they were infants in the faith, he gave them trials fit for infants. When they became strong in the faith, he gave them trials fit for the strong. Now, C.S. Lewis, if you ever read the Chronicles of Narnia, he gives us this principle in one of his books, where one of the main characters does the most brave and heroic thing that he's ever done. And instead of being granted a rest, he was immediately given a much harder task. And so Lewis said, "If you do one good deed, your reward usually is to be set to do another and harder and better one." And yet in this, as this does seem to be how God often works, we also have the assurance that Christ equips his people well for their trials. He does not give any of his people more than they can handle through him. When he calls one of his own to give up their life for him, he will equip them as well. I hope this gives you comfort in him. Because we all have to face trials of various kinds, and God has allotted enough grace for each trial that we face. When he calls you to endure sickness, there is enough grace available to do it with joy. And when he calls you to endure the death of a loved one, there is enough peace in his promises to sustain you. And when he calls you to endure persecution for his name, there is enough hope in heavenly rewards to give you contentment and even joy in your persecution. And the key in all these trials is that we lean on him. We trust him. We pray and we plead for his grace to come over us. And when we don't feel his presence, we must trust his word, which says he will never leave us nor forsake us. And when we don't think we can handle the trials that he has given, we must again trust his word, which says he will never give us a trial or temptation beyond our ability, but with the trial, he will provide the way of escape, the way to endure it. So let's pursue this a bit further, because you may be wondering, well, what do I do after I already did what you said? Right? You may be in this position. I lost someone, or I'm struggling with this disease, or I don't know where to go in life. I have no direction. I've prayed and I don't feel any better. Nothing's changed. I know the promises of God, but it just isn't working. And I'm ready to give up. Well, first, you must realize that you have never prayed enough that you are done praying. Because prayer is a daily discipline, a constant work. And second, you must know that God may call you to endure your trial without changing it. And so while you pray for your trial to change, pray also that your heart would change, even if your circumstances do not. Pray that you would be content with the providence of God for your life. Because God's providence, that's His ruling of creation, is the principal cause of everything that happens in this world. God has not given you any trials by accident. And so you can be sure that He will also equip you for those trials. So the question is, do you believe that God could give you true and complete joy in your life right now without your circumstances changing? Is God's glorious grace in the gospel of Jesus enough for you to have contentment and satisfaction where you are right now? If you are thinking, no, it's not enough, something must change first, well, then I would suggest to you that I don't think you have a proper understanding of who God is. You don't know your own sinfulness and its penalty. You don't know the glories awaiting those who are united to Christ. In order to have hope in earthly afflictions, we must know our heavenly rewards. We must know our status before God, and we must know God's goodness in His evidence. And His goodness ensures that everything done in this world is done to glorify Him. And if we have our hearts right, if we know the chief end of man, which is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever, then what glorifies God should be of the utmost importance to us. And so the solution, again, to facing our trials with joy is to learn these scriptural truths so that they could bring contentment in our sufferings. Now, there's one more step here that I see. Sometimes, maybe you answered yes to that question before. I know God's grace is enough, but I just don't feel it. Right here, yes, I know, but here I just don't feel it. So you can say, amen, that God could give me complete and fullness of joy in every circumstance, including right now, but I just don't feel it. Well, your task then is to work to bring your heart and your affections in line with what you know to be true with your mind. Your feelings, your emotions, must be subject to what you know to be true. To say it another way, instead of being governed by your current emotions, let the truth of God govern your emotions. Okay, I'll say that again. This is important. Instead of being governed by your emotions, let the truth of God govern your emotions. Now, this is a test of daily disciplined obedience in the Scriptures, reading and meditation, prayer, and also fellowship with your brothers and sisters in Christ. For example, you wake up in the morning and your current trial hits you smack in the forehead before you get out of bed. Right? Like a dark cloud in your mind, you're reminded of your loved one. You're reminded that you got fired from your job. You're reminded that you had a terrible argument with your spouse. And now your emotions are ready to bring you down. Right? They want to bring you into the depths of despair, of misery. And you may know God's truth. Right? You have the promises of God there, but it can feel so far away in the fog of your emotions that it may as well not exist. Well, now you have a task to do. You have to fight those lies. You have to fight that pain and those clouds. You have to go to the throne room of God to seek that clarity, that perspective. You have to seek hope and love and grace, forgiveness and humility. God will not turn you away when you seek Him. You will never regret going to God for help in your grief or in your struggles. But if you don't do that, if you continue to indulge in those sad thoughts, in your bitterness, or in your self-pity, then it will continue to have a hold on your heart. Then you will not know contentment and peace in suffering. Now I want to clarify, there is a time for grieving. Okay? God does not despise grief and sadness in our trials, especially the death of a loved one. But it is to be done with a hope that unbelievers don't have. So when you are grieving, God would not have you lying in your bed for the next 3 months, despairing of life. God would have you continue your life in service to Him, entrusting the soul of your loved one to Him. Or when you're dealing with personal illness or chronic pain, God would not have you give up in hopelessness, but rather to rejoice in the hope that one day you will have a body that is free from any and every pain. The suffering that you endure in any circumstance is not greater than the grace that you have received. And therefore, let us focus on the grace that God has given. Let it drive away the sting of our pain. In our tests of life, God is there, and His amazing grace is there. So may we seek it. And when we don't feel it, let us fall back on the promises and the character of God. Let us trust in our Savior who knows our strength. He will not give you something you cannot handle as you seek His help. Let's direct our minds back to the garden. Peter enters the scene in verse 10, bold as a lion. It says, "Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear." Now, judging by the fact that Peter's swinging a sword at the man's head, I think it's safe to say he was not trying to wound him. He was trying to kill him. Peter is full of zeal and passion. Right? He's ready to fight, ready to help his master. Now the problem is, Peter's zeal and passion has little to no regard for what his master actually wants. And so instead of helping, Peter actually gives some validity to the false accusations against Jesus being a rival to the current political power. And Jesus does not commend him. He quickly puts him in his place, reminds him of the mission, which is to go to the cross and endure the punishment. It's not to escape from it. Now, Peter should have thrown in his lot with Jesus. Because that's what he said he was going to do earlier that evening. Right? Even if all the other ones fall away, I will go with you to death. But Peter did what most of us would rather do, taking action according to what felt best in the moment. Right? He acted on his passions rashly without considering what Jesus had told him. Jesus had already rebuked him many times throughout the past few years in his ministry for his rash words and actions. Jesus was always telling him, "Listen to me, listen to what God wants. Obey the will of God, not your own will." But again, Peter acts out against the will of Christ. But it's really easy to sympathize with Peter, isn't it? It's like naturally he was fighting back, doing what maybe many of us would have done. And I think because it's easy to sympathize with Peter and to be understanding to him, that also means that we need to be all the more on guard against ourselves, because we tend to do the same kinds of things that Peter did. And Jesus was not happy with what Peter did. So acting with unfocused zeal and passions unguided by God's law is most often going to give the same kind of result. It's not going to please God. It's not going to advance God's kingdom. So here's the principle I think we can glean from Peter here. When you are full of zeal and passion to do something, especially when that passion is fueled by anger, stop yourself before you say or do anything and test what you want to do against the Word of God. Now, if you actually do this, you will prevent yourself from saying and doing many foolish things that you will later have to apologize for and seek forgiveness. Zeal and passion have their place, and they are commendable when done in accordance with God's will and not just our own. So may we all learn from Peter's mistakes by listening to Jesus first, then acting accordingly. Now let's look at the soldiers. You know, despite falling down in fear before Jesus only moments before, now the soldiers in verse 12 arrest and bind Jesus. They take him to Annas, the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who is the high priest at that time. Now Caiaphas is someone that we've heard of before, maybe you remember. John reminds us that he was the one who said it would be expedient for one man to die for the people. Now, if you remember the political context of that time, the Romans occupied the land of Israel. And so the Jewish leaders, the Pharisees, the chief priests, they were scared that if the people accepted Jesus as the Messiah, then Rome might see that as a political threat. And if they did see that that way, then they would possibly come to Jerusalem and remove the Jewish priests from power, and they would take over Jerusalem completely. Now, this was a real fear for them, and so Caiaphas, thinking as a man in the flesh does, thought that it would be best to just kill Jesus, even though he was innocent, and he would see it as a sacrifice for the good of the nation. If you'll turn in your Bibles to John chapter 11, we'll read there a little bit. So Caiaphas thought, well, if it's either the nation or Jesus that was going to suffer, better for it to be Jesus. Now, the problem with that plan is that God does not bless those who seek to gain through wickedness. The nation was not better off by performing a fake trial and killing an innocent man. Right? God is not mocked. People reap what they sow. But Caiaphas, though intending evil against Jesus and seeking personal gain, in the wisdom of God, was also prophesying the salvation of the world. He said way more than he truly knew. So let's look, John 11, verse 50. Caiaphas says, and he's talking to the chief priests, "Nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish." He did not say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who are scattered abroad. So from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. Now here we see a glimpse of God's infinite wisdom in using the wicked and selfish plans of men to accomplish his own good purposes. Right? Caiaphas is the one who pushed the Jewish leaders to crucify Christ. And though he did it for his own evil intentions, God, using the wicked tongue of this priest, set his own plan of salvation into motion. I'm reminded of Romans 11:33, where Paul says, "Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways." Brothers and sisters, consider this. If God can use such evil words to accomplish such a great salvation, how much more do you think he is able to accomplish good in your sufferings, in your trials. Look at the wisdom of God. He can use every evil purpose of Satan to accomplish his own good will. Let that inspire you to trust God with your trials, with your circumstances. Though Caiaphas knew that he was doing an evil deed, Jesus was actually in charge. Jesus was willingly going to his death. And not just for the nation of Israel, but for all the children of God scattered throughout the earth. I want to leave us with one final thought this morning. Again, let's consider Jesus was mediating. And he was mediating to the soldiers on behalf of his disciples. He said, "If you seek me, then let these men go." Well, Jesus gives us a hint here of what he was going to continue to do after his ascension to the right hand of God. Over there, he was talking to pagan men on behalf of his disciples, but now he talks to his heavenly Father, who loves him and has accepted his sacrifice. And so Jesus continues to mediate for all his people, all God's children scattered throughout the earth. And just like he asked that his disciples would be freed, so now he asks his father, that his followers would be freed. Not because of what they did, but because of his own finished work. And therefore, if you have received Christ as Lord and Savior, have believed in his name, and have rested in him alone for salvation, Christ will also plead on your behalf. He will ask the Father, not that you would be freed to depart, but that you would be worthy and free to come into the presence of God, fully clothed in his righteousness. And our assurance that the Father will grant everything that the Son asks is that he rose from the dead. So may we abound in this glorious hope. May it grant us everything we need and more to glorify God through all our trials and our joys. Amen.